Welcome, everyone. I'm Julian Guthrie, and I am the author of, the very proud author of, How to Make a Spaceship, A Band of Renegades, An Epic Race, and the Birth of Private Spaceflight. And we are joined today by some of my absolute favorite people, and some of the coolest people, the most innovative people, the most determined people you will ever meet. And a couple things first. So we also have a number of amazing folks joining us from around the world. We have the Space Tourism Society, we have National Space Society, Planetary Society, Mars Society, Space Frontier Foundation, the 100 Year Starship Project, Da Vinci Project, Yuri's Night folks, Commercial Space Flight Federation, Alliance for Space Development, Space Exploration Alliance, and numerous reporters as well. Welcome. So I'm going to talk a little bit just quickly about the book. I'm going to introduce our panelists. They're going to talk about, you know, really the coolest things, the most impressive things, the biggest dreams for 2017 in the realm of private space. And we have a few surprise guests also joining us. At the end of our discussion, we will have time for a Q&A, which will start at approximately 2:20 Pacific time, of course. We will start off in a moment with Peter Diamandis, who I see is always multitasking, and he's on his treadmill now in his office. And something on my computer here. So we have a special book offer and some cool things as well coming up in this webinar. We have, for those who buy a copy of How to Make a Spaceship before January 15th, 10 days from now, Peter and Anousheh and Bob Richards, and maybe we can even get Burt Rutan to sign these book plates, and we will send those to you. Neil, at the end of this broadcast, assuming he is able to join us, he will give the specifics for that, and we'll also follow up with all of you by email. We have a great giveaway at the end of this webinar as well, very coveted, hard to come by items, which are these pennies, which were flown to space on Spaceship One October 4th, 2004. And we have the esteemed Burt Rutan. We have others who are going to be joining us. So, as I said, I am the very proud journalist who did this story of how to make the world's first private spaceship. And it really makes the key word there. And it involves so many people who needed to come together to make the seemingly impossible dream come true. And it started with Peter Diamandis, who will speak shortly. He has to leave by 2:00 today. Isn't that right, Peter? Are you out there, Peter? He has to leave by 2:00. And then we'll also have Yonatan Weintraub, who is the co-founder of Space Israel, a Google Lunar X team. He has to leave by 2:00. He's in Israel. He's catching a flight. So we're going to start with them. But I love talking about this story, and I'm so excited that all of you joined. And I think it's going to be a really, really fun hour. It's a story about dreamers and doers and risk takers, and people like you who had this shared dream of a private path to space. And it really starts with Peter Diamandis. In my book, it starts with him as this wide-eyed 8-year-old boy in 1969 watching Apollo 11 land on the moon and being really transfixed by that. And he starts out on this incredible journey, this saga that I tell about in my book, where he just refuses to give up on this dream. So he is the founder of the XPRIZE. He is the co-founder of Planetary Resources, an asteroid mining company based in Seattle, which is doing really amazing things. And he obviously is an inspiration for the Google Lunar XPRIZE. We're also joined by Bob Richards, who's going to talk a little bit later. And did I miss Anousheh? I'm sorry. So Peter first, because you have to be off the line soon. Hey. Main character of this book. What are the most amazing things, your dreams, realities that you want to see happen or we expect to see happen in the space realm this year?
So first off, can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Great. So hello to all my friends. I can see Stu Witt and John Spencer and Bert and Bob and Anousheh and just Jonathan. So it's awesome. It's always fun. It's, you know, the thing that I realize is we are sort of a family of crazy space cadet misfits who refused what's expected of us, which is sort of, you know, leave it to NASA, leave it to the government to go, and in our sort of minds and genomes and whatever it is, this absolute desire. Neil, welcome. We're seeing your computer booting up on your desk here. In our sort of makeup is this. This relentless explorer gene that is driving us to—I'm giving this eloquent speech. Your computer, that would be great. There's this exploration gene that is refuses to give up, and that's, I think, what we all have in absolute common. I was reflecting on 2016 as an incredible year. We've had 4 or 5 XPRIZE teams sign contracts to get a translunar injection boost to go to the moon, which is kind of insane. We've had Soviets, US, China get to the moon. Hopefully a private company is going to get there next. We've got the line here. We had obviously some amazing reusability from Blue Origin and from SpaceX. I loved the fact that we had sort of Falcon 9 and Falcon 9 Heavy, and then, you know, New Glenn, and then the Mars Transporter. We have this sort of like this race of increasing capability of bigger and bigger rockets privately, which gives me a hope that we're going to actually colonize our solar system. We had $100 million committed from Yuri Milner for his Starshot project. Can we get a micro Pico spacecraft on a 0.2C trajectory to get to Alpha Centauri in the course of 20 years. So it's an exciting time. The thing that gets me most excited about right now is the transition from a government-dependent space program to a privately funded, entrepreneurially driven space program, one that's sort of driven by economics, one that's driven by private passion and not by national politics. At the same time, I would love a great race to Mars between China, Russia, U.S. that spurred us well in the 60s. So just, you know, in the space business, I truly believe more is better. And I think we're at an opportunity for a lot more. Having said that, Bert, I know you feel the same way as I would have never believed in 2004 that by 2017, we would not be taking private people to space.
We have almost nothing. I'm surprised that you're happy about 2016. If you had been described 2016 after the XPRIZE was won on October 4th of 2004,
I'm depressed about the facts.
What the hell happened? We've got nothing done.
I know it is. I'm excited.
Why aren't you horribly disappointed?
I am horribly disappointed about a lot of it. I'm excited about the amount of private capital being poured in by Bezos, by Elon, by Yuri Milner, by others that portend to not giving up. But it's ridiculous that we, you know, if Virgin Galactic only commercialized Spaceship One, we'd have flown already.
Do you recall the prediction that I made in my thrill of the moment out there on the microphone on Mojave's tarmac in front of Stuart Witt? In 2004, do you remember that prediction that I made?
You predicted 1 million people by 2020. No, what did you predict? I forgot.
100,000 people, and that we would have multiple space lines and multiple spaceports, and we would be getting cost down because we're competing each other for ticket prices. And instead of having 470 astronauts in the world, we would have many thousands by now.
Yes,
so
for sure.
I'm surprised to see any kind of smile on any of our faces.
Well, so let me turn it into a frown. I think it was you're predicting it based on what happened post Lindbergh in 1927, between 27 and 35, the transatlantic start and so forth. And you're right. So little has happened, but unlike the suborbital marketplace, you know, Falcon 9 and Falcon 9 Heavy and U Shepard and U Glenn are in fact vehicles that give us an opportunity for a continued human advancement.
And Peter, what's happening with planetary resources? And we can leave the Google Lunar part to Bob Richards.
Sure. So, you know, I'm a believer that to open up space, you need to have an economic engine. It can't just be based on political. It can be to some degree political will, right? It can be a U.S., Russian, Chinese race for, dominion. But that's not going to really open up space the way I think all of us want. And if you look back at what's driven humanity to open up space for all of the last, or open up environments and new frontiers for 500 years, it's been looking for resources. It's been economic engine. I call it an economic exothermic reaction. And ultimately, it's, you know, everything we've ever held of value on Earth, metals, minerals, energy, real estate, near infinite quantities. And I think from our perspective and other companies, some of which are on the line here, space holds the opportunity for resources, in particular fuel, hydrogen and oxygen, rocket fuel, construction materials, nickel, iron, cobalt, and platinum group metals. And so Planetary Resources was founded to go to near-Earth high-value asteroid targets to prospect them. And what's happened recently for PRI is a couple of things. One, we just closed a large $35 million A round backed mostly by the government of Luxembourg, which was very exciting to have a government do that. Back in November of 2014, 2015, the very Republican Democratic White House passed the laws for owning non-terrestrial resources, or at least being able to own resources you take off of a body. So that was great. And now the government of Luxembourg is passing very similar and even more aggressive laws. So we're creating that structure. And from our company, PRI, we launched our first satellite a year ago. We've got two more fully built that we are ready to launch as soon as SpaceX gets operational again. So it's an exciting time. Burt, you and I talked about this a while ago. It's either going to be that we're going to get really lucky in space, or we're going to focus on extending the healthy lifespan of humans so we can actually open up space. And
that's why you became a doctor.
Why I started human longevity. It's a
wonderful part of the story. In fact, I really did enjoy reading Julian's book because I learned an enormous amount of information that you never told me, even though
we were
drinking together many times. There was a lot more there than I expected.
There's that fun story, Burt, where you were telling me also, you were just incredulous listening to Peter saying he'd gone to Harvard Medical School and he'd done all this so that he could have a better chance of getting into the astronaut corps and also to, you know, improve his chances of living a really long time. So if he couldn't get there through the astronaut corps, he could get there.
And
you were like, who? What kind of space geek?
It's a bizarre thought that you would that you would, in between being a space nut, you would focus and realize, wait a minute, NASA's not working on the ability for me to fly in space. So I've got to work for a few years here to extend life so that I'll have another 100 years to do it.
Unusual.
I think you told me that story when we first met back in 94 or so. And I thought you were joking, but you really weren't, were you?
I'm dead serious.
In fact, that's why you're on a treadmill. The rest of us are becoming couch potatoes.
Yeah.
Even Sue is doing this. I'm surprised that you're optimistic, though. I would think you'd be extremely disappointed.
Julian, anytime you have Brett on the phone, there's no controlling the conversation.
I know. Burt, let me jump in here. Peter has to be off the line, and we have about 150 questions, including a few, including many that are aimed at Peter. So if you don't mind, Burt, I'll come back to you.
Oh, sure.
Okay, thank you. So, Peter, two questions that I thought, I mean, that kind of repeated themselves from folks who wrote in early. So we had one question that was interesting. How was the $10 million amount determined? Do you think that that was the right amount to incentivize?
Yeah, I honestly had been looking at suborbital flight myself and had been thinking about it for some time and then flipped the model to let's create a prize. And $10 million was, in my mind, it came to me, it was, we have 10 fingers, everything, you know, 10 is sort of a psychologically a powerful number. It sort of came in one fell swoop of that should be enough money to attract the entrepreneurs, but not the Boeings and the Lockheeds. And it was a nice round number. It correlated to Roman numeral 10 for experimental. It worked, and so it locked in very early, very quickly. And we rationalized. And Burt, you even thought you could do it for $10 million in the beginning, didn't you?
Well, did you realize at the time that it was to be the largest cash prize ever for anything in aerospace?
Yeah, it met that criteria for sure, but that wasn't the reason for it.
I mean, it's not like a Nobel Prize. That's just for, well, I won't go there.
For those of you who don't know the story, which I write about this part of it extensively, Peter drew his inspiration for this incentive prize after reading Charles Lindbergh's The Spirit of St. Louis and realizing, oh my gosh, he didn't fly as a stunt, but he flew to win this $25,000 prize offered in the 1920s by Raymond Ortega. And so he had this kind of aha moment where he's like, wow, what if I could incentivize private space travel in the same way that that the Ortega Prize galvanized the commercial airline industry. So that's a little bit of backstory. Peter, another question, which I think is really a great one, is about education. And this comes from some of my favorite people, Project Da Vinci, who Burt is working with, this team of high school students in North Idaho who are launching a CubeSat. And Burt is one of their inspirations, as is Peter. They want to know, What needs to happen in the education sector in 2017 to ensure we have more Burt Rutans and Bob Richards and Anousheh Ansari and Peter Diamandis and John and all of these innovative thinkers? What do you see? And you have some really interesting thoughts on education.
I wrote an entire, so I have 2 5-year-old boys. They're 5 and a half. They're going to kindergarten in 6 months. And I was trying to think about what would they, you know, what should they be learning? And I started thinking about the curriculum. And I think the current schooling curriculum we have is ridiculously 200 years old. And so I think it needs to be much more about helping a child find their passion. I mean, honestly, everything I've ever done in, I think I can speak for a number of the people on this amazing panel who I want to shut up and let them speak for a while, is that I was driven by passion. And so can you help a child find their passion early in life? And then fully support it, support them being curious, support them having grit, knowing that they have to work hard. But it's just a passion driven and get out of their way more than anything else. I just think, you know, coloring inside the lines is not the right idea.
You know, I had trouble putting my finger on what's happened to the schools until after I retired and I moved up here. I had an absolutely horrible experience giving a talk to Mojave High School. And when I moved up here, I wouldn't talk to high school kids anymore. they were uncontrollable by their teachers and whatever, and it was just horrible. I moved up here to Idaho, and I'm looking at people, every one of them is a passion. I talk to kids from 6 to 11 year old groups too in invention camp. And I talked to open a new charter school that and these little kids are working on robotics. I don't know how better to say this, but if you look at the difference between California schools and North Idaho schools, you will have the answer that you're all searching for. There's nobody up here that teaches political correctness because it's not a problem. There's nobody up here that worries about what bathrooms we go to because it's not a problem. And you see all this emphasis on stuff that has nothing to do with passion for engineering or science or physics and so on. The answer is absolutely obvious, and nobody wants to put their finger on it.
So, Burt, I need to go to Yonatan. Are you on the webinar here? Michelle, is Yonatan on? No.
Yeah, it looks like he's on.
Oh, okay. Yonatan, can you hear me?
It's a 2.4 second delay.
Okay. Yonatan is the co-founder of SpaceIL. I'm going to go to him first, and then we're going to go to Bob Richards of the Space Israel, the Google Lunar X Prize team. And he is his team is one of, I believe, 16 competing for a total $30 million in prizes. There are five teams, and Bob and Yonatan can do more specifics on this, that have launch contracts for 2017. This is for a team that can privately build a lander on the moon, traverse 500 meters, send images back to Earth. Yonatan, why don't you tell us about the most exciting things that you see happening with your team, with the Google Lunar team in 2017? Yonatan is in Israel at the airport.
Yes, he is.
Connecting.
Let me see if I can. Hello?
That is not Yonatan.
No, that's me.
This is a blank screen for him.
Yeah, I think he was saying there was just a delay because he's at the airport with the Wi-Fi connection.
Okay.
There he goes. There he goes.
Okay. Okay, great.
We can hear him.
Yonatan, are you there? Is the audio there?
He's talking. Yeah, we can't hear him.
Oh, shoot. Okay. So maybe if he can, Michelle, if you can fix that and we can reconnect with him.
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
We can hear you now. Did you hear my question?
Yes, I did.
Awesome.
Okay, so Google Lunar X Prize, as we see it, is a great example of the new space of having projects that are funded by not government, but funded by private entities. In SpaceIL, we're actually a nonprofit. We're getting funding from donations, and our chairman, Morris Khan, is one of the greatest contributors. As we enter the final orbit of this race, basically the deadline for the competition is later this year, things are really starting to warm up. And the team here in Israel is working very hard, and the team led by our CEO, Eran Friedman, is working very hard to get this lander onto the launch site and then on the launcher. But if your question is regarding how to build a spaceship, I think in today's new age, to build a spaceship, you also need to have outreach. For that reason, our educational space program is really, really important to create an outreach for students to dream about space, to think about becoming engineers, and to become about scientists. Because today's kids, they want to be rock stars, they want to be celebrities. I got to be honest, I started watching The Real Housewives of Orange County. That's exciting. But we also need a lot of engineers, a lot of scientists. And for us, the inspiration part is really important. We already reach over a quarter of a million students here in Israel and talked about space, and I've got them excited. And the following year, we're going to ramp up this and to create a blast of students that are going to be inspired. And hopefully, they would climb their own moonshots one day. And if one of them will get a Nobel Prize at the end of the decade or a couple of decades from now and say, you know, I wasn't that interested in science, but the space guys got me interested in science, I think we've done our share.
Yonatan, which team is getting to the moon first?
Obviously us. No, I'm kidding. I think that getting to the moon is hard enough. When you dive into the amazing things that the Apollo engineers did and the astronauts did at the time, to be honest, when I was a kid, you know, it seems so easy to land on the moon. But when you dive in, you see it's actually a real rocket science. And I think it's hard enough that if more than one team would get there, that would be a great, great achievement for humanity.
Why is there a limit on the prize? Why is there a time limit? That makes no sense at all, especially if you make expenditures trying to win it and then just run out of time. Shouldn't it be awarded to whoever does it first, whenever they does it? That's how it was done with Ortega and
Actually, Bart, you know this isn't this is true not the case. Ortega had a 1925 time limit on the prize when he first announced it in 1919, then he extended it. And as you know, with the X Prize, we had a December 31st, 2004 deadline.
Well, I know that, but I didn't. I guess my question would be better asked.
Well, I'll give you Larry Page and Sergey Brin's cell phones, and you can call and ask them.
I would like to add one last thing here.
Yes, please.
For me, this is really exciting panel. I got to be honest with you. I got inspired by Burt Rutan's Spaceship One. I saw that right off college, and I said, you know, I want to do something with space. And then I joined the International Space University that Peter Diamandis and Bob Richards founded. And this is where I actually got introduced for the first time with the Google Lunar X Prize. So for me, this is an amazing opportunity to be on this panel with those amazing people that provided inspiration for me.
Jonathan, that's a really great story of your inspiration, and thank you for joining us. I know you're about to, if you have more time, hang out, but I know you were supposed to be, I think you're at the airport, you were jumping on a flight, right?
Yes, I am. Thank you so much.
Thank you for joining.
Thank you.
Okay, so I would like to go next to Bob Richards. Bob is a great individual in my book, and he goes way back with Peter Diamandis. He was a co-founder of the International Space University and got involved in SEDS early on, and is the quintessential space geek dreamer. I say that all positively. I have so much admiration for you, Bob. And Bob today he's a space visionary. He is the leader, I forget what your title is, you can tell us, of Moon Express, an American-based Google Lunar X Prize team that also has plans for a launch this year in 2017. Bob, tell us the latest and any, you know, big plans, dreams, reveals for 2017.
Sure, Julian. So it's great to be this with this crowd. Like Peter, I was I was a child of Apollo, and then quickly orphaned by Apollo. This false dawn of promises that were made to we kids of what a fantastic future we're going to aspire to. And of course, it wasn't there, but now we're living this, even though it's taking a little bit long, it always takes longer than we want, but it's just, we're at this cusp, this emergence of this spacefaring civilization that we were dreaming about as kids, and we're participating in it. So this has been a long journey for me. I was honored to be in front of the Arch of St. Louis back in 1996 when Peter announced the prize. I watched Burt stand and give the keynote at the banquet and declare that he wanted to win the what became the Ansari X Prize. I was honored to be there during both Spaceship One flights. Those moments to me in 2004 were riveting. Even though I believed in such a future, that really redefined what possibilities could be. And so when the Google Lunar X Prize was announced by Peter with the backing of Google in 2007, I was the first one to sign up with a team called Odyssey Moon at the time, and had brought together a number of, I was working out of Canada. We had formed Odyssey Moon as an Isle of Man company offshore. And for the first few years, Odyssey Moon was the first team to sign up. And it wasn't until 2009 and 2010 until I transitioned into the United States and formed Moon Express, which is now, I'm the founder and CEO along with Naveen Jain and Barney Powell of Moon Express. Odyssey Moon, I'm proud to say, actually merged with Space IL. So there's a little bit of of legacy there that I'm proud of. I'm proud of the International Space University connections, not just with SpaceIL, but with a lot of the Google and XPRIZE teams. For Moon Express, I'm here in Washington, D.C. right now, but I'll be heading back just in a few minutes to Cape Canaveral. We're on our path to launch to the moon this year, Julian. We've done very well with our funding. Like Planetary Resources, we've raised a significant amount of capital. Next week, to give you a tantalizing preview, we'll be making a big announcement regarding our further funding. And we're all set to be heading to the moon at the end of this year. Last year, we had a couple of very big firsts in commercial space. One is that we became the first private company ever to receive the required government authorization to leave Earth orbit and go somewhere. Only government missions have ever left Earth orbit. So there's a treaty that nations are obliged to recognize called the Outer Space Treaty that dictates the behavior of nation states in space, and any private citizen or company within a nation state is subject to that treaty through its provisions. So because only government missions and no private company has ever gone beyond a traditional Earth orbit, there was no framework in place here in the United States. So we had to work with the White House and the FAA and NASA and all of the agencies that care about space. And not unlike, I think, what happened in the regulatory reform that made the Ansari XPRIZE possible and Burt Rutan's win possible for the regulatory front, we had to create our own regulatory framework too to allow us to launch this year to the moon. So in August, we announced we became the first private company with that authorization for a private mission to the moon. Last year, we also announced that we've taken over not one, but two launch complexes at Cape Canaveral. And we took over the former Delta pads, which were operational just about 4 or 5 years ago. Actually, the last U.S. mission to the moon launched from Launch Complex 17, which is becoming our new home. And we'll be cutting the ribbon on that facility just in a few months. So Moon Express, we have a contract with another startup called Rocket Lab USA. So we're a startup betting on a startup. That is building a rocket that is yet to launch, and we're hoping for their first test launch in March. And we're hoping that their learning curve is such that we will be an operational launch, hopefully number 7 at the end of this year. Launching unexpectedly from New Zealand, even though we have launch complexes at Cape Canaveral, where we hope to develop, test our vehicle, and eventually maybe launch small launch vehicles. Rocket Lab USA actually has a launch range down in New Zealand. So here we have, unexpectedly, when I signed up for the XPRIZE, the Google Lunar XPRIZE, here we have our first launch to the moon is going to go from New Zealand, from a company building a rocket led by Kiwi, with a spacecraft of a company in the United States led by a Canuck, a Canadian. So it's a global effort here. And I'm very excited the way that space is formulating itself into a global enterprise through entrepreneurship and this new era of can-do, small teams doing what only superpowers could do before. It's very exciting, standing on the shoulders of giants.
It's beautiful, and it's really neat for me to know your story from way back when as this determined space dreamer from then to now. And I didn't get to watch you grow up, but I somehow feel like I did. And you have the same, you know, it's the same with most of everybody on this panel, where you have the same dream and you're making it a reality. And, you know, despite the odds or against the odds and, you know, finding ways to innovate, it's really, really pretty amazing. So one question for you before we go to Anousheh Ansari, another one of my favorite people. Why, for those who are not, you know, enamored with getting off planet, what is it for you, Bob, that has been such a abiding passion?
Sure. I think Peter mentioned the exploration gene. Some of it is more manifest in some of us than others. And you only need a small percentage of a species to have this innate desire to climb that mountain, to cross that river, that ocean, to go to that island, to go to that other planet. It's I think it's part of our survival tactic as a species, of all species. We need to become a multi-world species. There are economics, as Peter had mentioned, in space that will support us as we move out. Infinite energy and resources out in space, opportunities for new ways of living, of political, socio-political systems. I see the moon in particular as an opportunity for we as a species to conquer a new frontier without having to conquer each other. And this is really the first frontier that's presented us this way. There's no tall blue people there that we're going to displace that we know about anyway. And I think how we behave in these next, few years as a species moving out responsibly from Earth is going to be very important to paint the picture of how ready we are to move out into space as a multi-world civilization.
Thank you. So stay on, because we've got a number of questions for you. Anousheh Ansari. So she is an amazing woman and entrepreneur and engineer and the world's first private female space explorer, traveler. She spent 10 days at the International Space Station. She came in and rescued, she and her family came in and rescued the XPRIZE when they needed it most, along with another amazing person who isn't with us, but Eric Lindberg. So Anousheh, love to talk with you about what your kind of goals and dreams are for this year, 2017, as it pertains to your true love, space.
Well, I think a lot of people talked about how activities around private space exploration has really come to fruition, I think, last year, and I hope that it will grow further this year. We have a lot of different missions, from asteroid mining Mars, mission to Mars, and just sending private citizens to fly to space, even if it's a suborbital flight. So all of those excites me, but I'm also very excited about how, in general, the attention from the general public has shifted towards space. I think Hollywood is one measure of that, and I've seen a lot more of interesting movies being made about space exploration. That shows that the public interest is increasing. And there was a period that young kids had lost sort of interest because they felt this is such a unreachable dream or unreachable goal to have. And now they see possibilities. So there's I meet a lot of students who are excited about internships they can have with a lot of the companies we've been talking about, and how that will help them, you know, become part of building this future that space is a big part of. And all of that is really exciting. It's also exciting to see a group of astronauts that are coming together now, and I'm working with them to help, you know, use the experience that we've had, which has helped us see the world in a new light and have hope for a better future, and use that experience and try to somehow find a way through technology, through other means, to sort of transfer that experience or allow them to experience that as well, until we get an opportunity to fly everyone to space, of course, so that we can actually, you know, become better stewards of our home planet and become better citizens of this planet, working better together like all the astronauts do on the space station. So, I think this is all very exciting to me, and I can't wait to see the winning Google Lunar X Prize, taking the trophy and celebrating their successes.
So Anousheh, you told me this fun story of when you were a little girl growing up, which is in the book, growing up in Iran, you said that you used to sleep out on your grandmother's porch area balcony, and you had this, what seemed to me crazy, dream, you prayer almost every night when you'd sleep outside, and you would, I love this. Can you tell about this? Like, it just shows how you had it really bad from the very beginning to get off planet. What was your prayer?
So I, of course, I wanted to go to space, so I didn't know how exactly I would go to space. So one of the ways I was hoping it may happen is, you know, maybe aliens could come and abduct me and take me with them. So that was, you know, that was one of the prayers I had. So like most people would be afraid of aliens and people doing experiments on them. I'm like, they can do whatever experiment they want. I just want to be able to feel the freedom and the weightlessness and experience being.
Well, of course, in 2004, you had Richard Branson wanting to abduct you too.
Remember that? Yeah, but fortunately, he was not very successful at that. But yeah. It's one of those. Things that, you know, Peter talked about passion and Burt talked about passion. I think, you know, I, for whatever reason, I was in a family where they sort of allowed me to have crazy dreams and talk about them and pretend that I'm riding my spaceship. And they encouraged me and they let me dream big. I think that's something very important that needs to happen for children at a young age. So they can actually pursue those dreams and find their way in this world, because that's even more important as we get older, because that passion is what fuels every step we take and how we shape our lives. And having found that dream and that passion at an early stage, it will allow us to be better prepared to live that life to the fullest.
So, and Anousheh, you went on to take a chance and fund the XPRIZE when more than 150 people had turned Peter Diamandis down. And last question, I know we need to move on here. We're going to extend this by about 5 minutes because we also have representatives, I believe, from Team Indus joining us from India. It's the middle of the night there. So Anousheh, why did you say yes to Peter when 150 plus people had said no, when he was seeking his $10 million for this, you know, first privately built and flown spaceship, basically? Why did you say yes? Was it because you were an entrepreneur? Was it just your space?
I guess I didn't understand why 150 people said no. It was like obvious to me that it's a great way if you wanted to do something in space and make a difference and you really create better future in space, this was a very sort of safe bet because it was a prize. It was a way not to just you know, try to decide what technology will win and how and which team will win, but you're basically betting on everyone, so you're actually reducing your risk. So I didn't understand why everyone else said no, and I thought it was a great investment. Of course, Peter was very persuasive, and I think his passion was contagious. And you know, when I looked at him and I saw how dedicated he was to this mission, I knew that if I just, you know, hitch my wagon to him, I will find a way to get to space, whether it was through him, through XPRIZE, through one of the winners of the prize or in future. So to me, it was a, you know, sort of one of the safest bets that I could make if this was my passion, which was.
Well, you are a proven risk taker and but a savvy one. So stay on. Burt, I want to ask you, there's a scene in the book, there's a story that I just loved and where you had kind of tears in your eyes when you were telling me about it. And that is the, I believe it was the morning of your first flight, June 21, 2004, when you're first attempting to reach the start of space, the 100 kilometers. And early in the morning, you know, set the scene for thousands of people pouring into the Mojave Desert. Burt and his team of fewer than 30 people had built this, you know, world's first private spaceship on their own. And you have tens of thousands of people flocking into the desert. And there's this really wonderful thing that Burt does that I love that is very Burt Rutan. So Burt, can you tell us a little bit about that and why it meant so much to you to see the hordes of people and to talk to them?
The fact that the public was invited to what was a very large extension of a flight test envelope first time we had ever done that. I feel very personally about that because my sponsor did not want to do that. He wanted to have the press there. He wanted to have a very big list of VIPs there, but I wanted to have the public there because I wanted kids there to be able to sometime in the future tell their grandchildren that they were there, like a lot of people could tell their grandchildren that they watched Lindbergh arrive in Paris. You know, I felt very strongly about that. So Tanya and I decided to fund ourselves, and actually Stuart Witt helped later, the airport manager, but we decided to fund ourselves the cost of letting the public in and having the security and the latrines and so on. So I had a period of about an hour and a half that morning that I didn't have any specific duties on. And I knew that people were coming in and I just wanted to be close to them. So somebody told me who was the first one that arrived.
And you went out
in the car, right? I actually looked them up and I banged on their door. And they had been here. I had no idea who they were, but they pointed out they had been here, I don't know, for a day or two. And I just wanted to thank them for their interest. And then I went down and helped park the cars for a little while. And you know, it was a thing that took a lot of the stress away of that morning. We were going from a vehicle that had only flown to 220,000 feet to one that needed to fly to 100 kilometers and 328,000 feet. And we were doing it right out there in front of the public and the world press. So there's a lot of pressure there. But that hour and a half, I actually enjoyed the fact that I had nothing specific that I had to do with my team. It was an emotional moment for me. It really was.
And Stuart Witt, are you still with us, I hope? So Stuart, you were with Burt and you went out and you saw all of this and you were the one who, so Stuart Witt was the director of the Mojave Airport who pushed to make it the Mojave Air and Spaceport. And really a former Top Gun pilot, an amazing man, and a great character in this book as well. Stuart, tell us, you know, just how was the impossible possible? How was this whole thing pulled off, if you can sum it up? You know, with people like Burt Rutan and Peter and Anousheh and all of these space dreamers who are with us today.
Julian, thank you. And to Anousheh and Burt and Peter and the whole gang and all the listeners out there, thanks. And to Julian, what a great book. I mean, I got to read it twice. I got to read the proof and comment and then the final version, and I couldn't put it down the second time. So I got to live it, but I also got to read the story. So thanks. Somebody has a phone going off. So to answer your question, it's real simple, Julian. When you have people with great, just fantastic ideas. Idea because substantially meaningless unless you can connect it with people with means and then give them a place where permission is granted to actually execute on a good idea. And so it's the perfect storm. You got a guy like Burt Rutan, who's the modern day genius of aerospace design and ideas. And Burt's not bound or burdened by what a vehicle should look like. You know, if you put a classroom of kids in a room and gave them a pen and a paper and said, draw a picture of an airplane, I guarantee you every one of them would draw a tube with a wing, but not Burt. Burt wouldn't pick up the pencil until he'd look back at you and say, well, what do you want it to do? And he thinks differently. And so you have a creative mind that can think in terms of what do you want it to do? And then through Peter, you had the means, the dot connector, the Don King of this industry that actually promoted and connected the dots and found Anousheh and Amir. And you brought the means, and then they needed a place. And so that's how you had the perfect storm. And to me, it's frankly not that hard to figure out. When I travel around now and talk to people on different continents and things, it's not hard to find good ideas. It's not hard to find people with means. It's difficult to find the people with a good idea and connect them with the people of means and then give them a place to actually do it. The third piece in Western society is actually harder and harder to find these days, because we have become enormously risk averse in the last two generations of Western society, where the taking of risk is, in some civilizations, is thought of as illegal.
So you were, I know how instrumental you were, and thank you for being a part of this, and a lot of fun to spend time with in the Mojave. So we need to jump around a little bit before we get to John Spencer. If Michelle, is Team Indus on the line? Do we have representative? Hello?
Hi, this is Raul. I'm from Team Indus.
Oh, great. Raul, so nice to meet you and so nice to joining. So nice of you to join us. Tell us a little bit about your background and about Team Indus. Team Indus is another one of the five teams, right, that also has a launch contract for the Google Lunar Prize for 2017. Launch contract to land on the moon in 2017, correct?
Yeah, launch contract to launch for the moon. So just on the quick background, I had a regular job exactly 6 years from 6 years ago until I saw black skies on a flight. So I blame what I do today on two folks on this conference today. So Burt Rutan and Peter, I blame my state affairs of my life. I'm in my pajamas, it's 4 a.m. and I'm talking to this global audience. So thank you so much for being my inspiration to attempt something as crazy as the Google Lunar X Prize. I'm the team lead. Team Indus is the only team in the Google Lunar X Prize from India. We were the last team to register. I think it's been a combination of inspiration, the kind of ecosystem that X Prize has created, a whole bunch of new space companies in the Valley, a whole bunch of new space companies coming up in India that have helped us progress and come to a point wherein we finally signed a launch contract with ISRO a couple of months ago. So that's the inspiration. It's been a unique journey. It'll need a book to tell, you know, talk about the last 6 years. So let me just summarize here saying, extremely privileged to be part of this exclusive club. Look forward to 2017. I think this year could mean great stuff in private space, especially because of what's happening at the Google Lunar X Prize.
So nice of you to join at 4 a.m. in India. And we will be following you closely. And it's really neat to hear how the story of the X Prize, the story of Burt Rutan, Spaceship One, all the other teams in the hunt, the story that I was so lucky to get to tell, how it inspired this next generation and this next generation. I think that's something probably everybody involved is most excited about in terms of the legacy of this story and the continuum of this story. Thank you for joining. I want to go quickly to John Spencer, who is one of those diehard space lovers, dreamers, has been a space architect for 30 years and is head of the Space Tourism Society. So, John, because you've been, you know, in this, living this, dreaming this for so long, kind of can you give us a sense of where we've come from and where we are from your perspective, the good, bad, and ugly, and you know, focusing again on where we are 2017?
Yes, and first off, thank you very much for putting this all together. It's been fun to reconnect with everyone, and I think the words we've heard a lot is passion and never giving up and grit and all those kind of things. And that's whether you're a space pioneer or a pioneer in medicine or a pioneer in other areas, the passion always comes across to try to make the world a better place. space happens to have the advantages of the magic of being space and looking at the Earth from space. And I'm very happy Anousheh had the opportunity to do that and fulfill her dream. But I think one of the big picture things here is, and Stu started talking about this, is the space community. It's a community of visionaries and pioneers and people who don't give up, who believe in what we're doing, who care about it, who love it, and know we're making a difference. And that's one of the key things. We're making a difference and living lives of fulfillment by doing so. So getting involved in the space community allows you to be part of something that's special, part of something that's moving forward, and really truly is for all mankind. Now, what I've seen happen over these years is a great diversification. New people getting involved, new businesses, new financial resources. And that's very exciting. What you'll see happening in 2017 and beyond is an expansion of this diversification and more capabilities and more talents and more ideas and new ideas coming forward that diversifies even the diversification. So I'm very optimistic. There's been hard times and good times, but the future is very bright, and we will never, never give up. And it's a great way to enjoy your life by being part of the space community.
Thank you so much. So we are going to go now and try to answer some of your questions. So everybody stay on. We have specific questions for the esteemed panelists here. Anousheh, let me start with you. A question has come in about why there are so few women in girls, in young women in the space field, and what can be done to improve that situation for girls, young women to follow along in the path that you, this trail that you have blazed.
So I think, as I mentioned before, I think it starts at the young age. I think the encouragement has to happen when young girls are just deciding what's important in life and what they're passionate about and what they want to do. And unfortunately, in a lot of cases, what we see is not only they don't get any encouragement, they're discouraged from entering any field that there's risk involved or there's any type of, you know, things that general public may think it's hard for women to do. So it's amazing that we are having this conversation 2017. It's something that you know, by now I think women probably have proved that they can do whatever they set their minds to. So we shouldn't have to even have this conversation. But unfortunately, it's still the case where in many households or many societies or communities, women are discouraged from entering in fields of science, technology. And also, even here in the United States, I think not having enough role models highlighted for young girls at an age where they are making decisions about their careers also doesn't give them the opportunity to see what life could be like if they are astronauts, if they are scientists, if they are inventors, engineers. And, you know, being able to provide those role models and highlight them in a way they can, you know, help young girls, it will go a long way.
And read more about Anousheh Ansari. Follow her. Her story's in the book. A quick question for Bob Richards, because he has to get take a flight. This is an on the move group, clearly.
An airplane flight, not a rocket flight.
Yes. But, so many, many people want to know why Moon, not Mars, or Moon and Mars, when Mars, okay. A lot of people are very Mars inquisitive.
Right. I think it's a false dichotomy, Julian. I really do. Okay. So the answer is not either or, it's both. It's all of the above. And as humanity reaches out, as the private sector partners with government and finds economic reasons to move into space, those journeys can't be so far that there's no economics. So Mars is a wonderful destination. I was honored to be involved in the NASA Phoenix Mars lander mission back in 2007, checking a bucket list for me. I was inspired by Carl Sagan. I was a student and I loved Mars, and I was honored to be involved in this mission that landed in the North Pole of Mars. But there's no economics there yet. That is a destination for the future. Absolutely. Humanity will evolve to Mars. But the moon is a stepping, it's not just a destination, it is a stepping stone. It's a world not unlike an island on the horizon. If you're trying to learn how to paddle in the ocean, you want to go to the island first. It has resources. One of the game changers that we've discovered fairly recently is the verification of the water on the moon. So water is the most valuable resource. It's like the oil of the solar system. It's the game changer, not just for resources on the moon, but for transportation everywhere. The moon is now a gas station in the sky. So we're so lucky as a species to have this sister world. And so the moon is an important part of our economic sphere as we move outward, and not so far that it's impossible for the private sector to follow. So as the public-private sector engine moves outward, the moon to me is a logical step and a valuable destination in itself. And it's also going to be a great place to go. And we're going to redefine what honeymoon really means.
I love that. Thank you. Bob, I know you have to go. The rest, please stay with me here. We have some exciting announcements coming up. So Bob, thank you. Wishing you the best. I know it's going to be an amazing 2017. And I loved getting to write about you, and more chapters to come.
Thank you. It's been such an honor to be with this group, and buckle up for 2017. It's going to be exciting. So long, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Burt, are you still with us?
Yes.
Okay. So why is it that you, when you were a kid and you were making those model planes out of the balsa wood pieces, why wouldn't you follow any sort of already made, ready-made kit? Why did Burt Rutan always have to do something different?
I, as a kid, had no idea why. There is a possibility that my religion had something to do with it. I was brought up a Seventh-day Adventist, so I could do nothing between sundown Friday night and sundown Saturday night. My mom even had to cook the food for that 24-hour time period because cooking food was working and we didn't do that on the Sabbath. What it meant is I couldn't do sports. I couldn't go to dances. I couldn't do a lot of things that kids in my school, I went to public schools only after I was a sophomore in high school. So I couldn't do anything a lot of the things that kids did. So I searched for something that was fun and challenging. And I think I lucked out very, very early in what was the church's version of Boy Scouts. I won a big trophy with the model airplane idea that I had done. I built a model of an airliner that had, obviously it was an airliner, had windows on it, but it looked more like the 707 when the only jet airliner at the time was the British Comet. And I was somehow buoyed by winning something. In those days, they didn't give out participation trophies and hesitate on making someone a winner. But I was a winner, and I was clearly a winner. And I think if they were just passing out participation trophies then, I'd have never had a creative career ahead of me. But I wanted to win. I wanted to win big. I worked on it just night and day, trying to win the next trophy with model airplanes. So I had winning and beating the other guy in my blood. The competitiveness of that, which some people think nowadays is politically incorrect for children, that competitiveness is, I think, the main reason that I was able to develop. Actually, I'm doing my 47th new research airplane now.
Well, thank you, Burt. You are a living legend, and I don't use the word genius lightly, and you are, and you're a lot of fun to talk to and spend time with. And I think, Burt, do you have 5 or 6 planes in the Air and Space Museum in the Smithsonian?
Yes.
5 or 6?
Well, I thought it was seven, but I haven't counted lately. Not all of them, not all of them are on display at the mall or the Hazi. But the one I'm most proud of course, is in the Milestones of Flight gallery, where Spaceship One hangs alongside the Spirit of St. Louis and the Apollo 11 capsule and the Wright flyer used to be in there. The first airplane to break the speed of sound. And that's where the Air and Space Museum has places artifacts that they consider milestones in aerospace. And I'm most proud to have Spaceship One there. It spent the first 10 years there in the launch configuration, and they hung it in the re-entry feathered position 10 years after the flight. Which, so you see it quite differently now than you would the last 10 years.
Well, thank you for being here, and thank you so much for letting me tell your amazing story about making Spaceship. So we have a few final things to finish up with. Neil, I believe, is on the line. Neil, do you want to go over the Space Pennies winners and also where to find the replay of this and the promotional consideration aspects?
Indeed. Okay. First, thank you, Julianne. Well, it's obviously, folks, you've got just a taste today of some of the amazing people that are in Julian's book. And I hope that you'll have a chance to purchase this before the end of this broadcast, because I have to tell you, when I bought it and I read it, it kept me up at night for all the right reasons. So make sure, before you leave this broadcast today, to go and order your book, and you'll have the special offer that's available and only to people on this webcast. And that includes getting a autographed version of it, not only from Julian, but Anousheh Ansari, Peter Diamandis, and Bob Richards. And that's a very, very unique opportunity. And
maybe we can even get Burt to sign a few.
You know, if you act now, this offer may not be repeated. And it is, I can definitely say, it's not available in any store.
No.
So in any event, I really want to thank everybody for having joined today, but this offer will end at the end of the broadcast. And just in case, you can always go to Amazon and your favorite Barnes & Noble bookstore after the broadcast to get some for your friends and relatives. In addition, I just want to give a shout out and promotional consideration to Zoom.us. They've been absolutely marvelous to us throughout this entire experience. They are a state-of-the-art company, and that's why we selected them. So we hope that you'll look into them further, because you can see the end product that resulted today. I'd also like to thank Newswire.com. They were amazing and twice reaching out to the press, and I just want to really thank them for that. In terms of the big reveal here today, the names of the people who have graciously joined this webcast have been entered into a hat, and Michelle Price has had the distinction of picking those names. So, if we can now get some of those names sent over to Julian, hopefully we can start making some announcements here as to these unique space pennies. And Julian, I'm sure that you'll want to actually give about a minute's discussion, a background on the significance of these space pennies and what they represent.
Well, I mentioned it at the very beginning, but these are pennies that were flown by Paul Allen's team, by a wonderful guy named Dave Moore, who worked very closely, was the liaison between Burt and his team and Paul Allen, who the funder who backed Burt's dream, and actually Paul Allen's shared dream. But as ballast, as weight, they added a lot of they put on these pennies to later thinking that they would be great mementos for space lovers. These pennies are not for sale, they're not for resale, and they're only for winners. You have to be 18 years old, according to the rules of this sort of giveaway. Again, not for sale or resale. They're really collectible treasures. They're very hard to come by, and They are little examples of doing the impossible, because these were flown on Spaceship One, designed by Burt Rutan, built by his small team in the desert, flown by Brian Benny on that day, who had a great comeback story. So the pennies represent a lot, and I hope that they will mean something very near and dear to those who have them. They'll come with a little card as well, which will tell you about that particular flight. And so I think we can, Michelle, do you just want to announce this, or do I have the info?
You have the info. I sent it to you. You should have it.
I have the info that we I only have the emails, but we have an A. Peterson, and we have a Patricia at Center for Space Innovation, and we have a, from my glasses here,
John Strack.
John Strack at lock.com. So we will contact you. You are the lucky space penny recipients. We'll contact you and get those out to you following up with this. And I just wanted to say thank you. It's an honor to be able to tell this story. And I look at the people who were on this panel who told me their stories. And it took so much perseverance, and there was a lot of risk involved, and there were these big dreams, and there was great innovation, and really kind of these off-the-grid mavericks embodied by, you know, Burt Rutan, who we have talking with us. And, you know, again, the shared dream of all of those who joined today, and many of you out there, you know, John Spencer has had this dream for years, and Peter, what he was able to galvanize. And the title of the book, How to Make a Spaceship, was very carefully chosen, because you make it, you make your dreams come true, whatever your spaceship is, so to speak. You know, it's my hope that you make that happen, and that this story is very inspiring. So there's a great quote, go confidently in the direction of your dreams. And I think that that really is very representative of the story that I've written and the story of the people who you've just met in our webinar. So thank you all. It's been a lot of fun. And don't hesitate to follow up with us, and we'll get those pennies off to you. And I hope you all enjoyed this, and thank you for joining. And thank you to our really wonderful panelists, to my friends, to the people I got to write about, to these inspirational pioneers.
All right.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. So signing off. Great thing, right. 2017.
All right. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Take care.